folks. It's Lorenzo Dom from Lawful Limited and the Magnetic Force.
Kid T, Rockwell Association, Bronx, New York.
Welcome to the Style of Boogie, where the real history and stories will be told.
So, introduce yourself, Amoretto.
So, I'm Amoretto Jessica Lopez. I'm one of the three ladies of the smash hit single freestyle song, Clave Rocks.
Dale huevo.
Yeah.
Wow. Dude, that's my song.
That song really, it put us on the map as far as females coming up to the guy on the dance floor and saying, ay papi. So it was something I've heard over and over that a lot of girls had babies that summer, including one of our own. Yeah, Trilogy.
Trilogy.
Her name is Annette Bermudez, and I love her with all my heart. She covered some shows for us in Florida, and she met one of the guys from Trilogy, and that's, for me, the official ay papi baby. I have to get a picture of him. He's in college now.
Oh, yeah. He's really one of those.
Yeah, they met like that. Because she was doing Clave Rock, ay papi, and he saw, and that was the end.
Who actually said that in the song?
Well, I do the parts. I do hacha, ay papi. Yeah, the hacha.
I love that.
The beat, the heat, rhythm.
Oh, so that's you.
Passion, you and me. Ay papi.
Dude, I love that.
And then I do the ay papi. I'm the one in the background doing the ay papi.
Ay
papi. It got me in a lot of trouble, that song. It did get me in a lot of trouble.
And how many children do you have from it?
Oh, no. I didn't go there. I was busy drinking. I'm a partying.
What year did that song come out?
In 1986. We debuted January 10th, 1986 at Roseland Live at 12:10 in the morning. Right? Nice. 10 minutes after midnight. I changed my life. From that point on, I never went back to working at Pathmark.
Wow. So when I reached out to Amoretto and I actually spoke.
How
to
do
her.
You know her too?
I just reached out to her, on social media. I'm like, hey.
Well, I noticed that you post on Electric. Go ahead.
So I seen her getting involved with the community of Electric Boogie, and I realized that she's a freestyle singer, and you know, one of the old school singers, and I'm like, wow, that's awesome. So I kind of reached out and see if she got back to me. She did, and so we talked. And you know, she amazed me on the knowledge of history that she has on freestyle and how freestyle music started. And she was like, "It's not freestyle." So I'm like, "Oh, I got educated!" Like, boom.
Well,
so
I'm going to be interested because you know I have my own perception of it.
Right, well, so, you know. It was not called freestyle when I came into the scene.
What was it
in
called?
In fact, when I came into the scene, I was Lisa's backup single.
That's my homegirl.
On live tours, I Wonder If I Take You Home and Can You Feel the Beat.
And so how did I never meet you?
Because I was one of those that just slipped through because I was always in a group setting. I'm actually solo now, guys. I got my own new song I just
Congratulations.
Released. I'm releasing it as we speak. I'm waiting for Amazon to approve it.
Good.
It's now on Apple.
Good. We would love iTunes, to get the link to it.
I have the USB stick with me today. Yeah. You guys can hear it. Mm-hmm. But I am, for the first time, on my own completely now as a solo artist. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I was stuck on the three-girl thing. I still want to do one show with. That's why I was reaching out. If there was any Boogaloo dancers, Electric Boogie. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I'm thinking of going
Electric
that.
Boogaloo.
I'm thinking of going in that direction, not so much with the break dancing and the spinning on the head. It's kind of hard for me to sing with the other two. If there's a way I can incorporate that type of steps into what I'm doing now, where people that can sing a little bit, move well, but
well,
Lost
and Boogie makes sense. Breakdancing,
it's not gonna work. Right. Even though
it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Doesn't
so that's
work.
Where I'm at. We can talk about this later, identifying if there's any female dancers I'm looking for too.
Yep.
I have a girl I'm working with now. Her name is Yvette LaBoy, and I'm looking to work with her as part of the front, the three front women. Mm-hmm. But I'm still thinking of expanding this whole thing and bringing it back to a stage, which is I was part of that. Mm-hmm. No one's bringing that out the way they should be. I see the Judy Torres do her show. I see Cynthia do their show. I see, Lizette Melendez do their show. All of them do the show, but there's I don't see that part coming through in the
It's different, and I'll be honest. Listen, I was just in Radio City. I was with Lisa. Yeah. This is about 3-4 months ago. I went to see her. You know, they had the big event. They had TKA, George Lamont, Lisa, Fascination,
Little Susie.
Little Susie. And believe it or not, the only two that impressed me out of that whole thing, well, there were others, but the two that really impressed me, of course, George Lamont, because he has a great voice and he's good at what he does. And believe it or not, Lisa does all her shows like she's doing a concert.
Yeah.
She plays no games.
Yeah.
You know, the other ones...
Well, she's a Columbia Records artist. Mm-hmm. We were signed to Columbia Records. Mm-hmm. I got pretty paid very well to be her backup singer back in the day.
Well, now she's with Tony Minaj.
Yeah.
Tony Minaj is her backup
very
singer.
Nice.
Yeah. She, but, you know, but to get back to what you were just saying, that, you know, if you remember back, I'm not sure if you go back as far as the Roxy 1018.
Yeah, of course.
So,
I go back.
You know, it was weird because... all the artists treated that stage like they were performing in a huge concert,
yeah.
You know? And now some people, to me, are doing it just because they need the paycheck, right? So they come on board and they you know, I'm not going to name who, but even that particular night, I saw some acts and I was like, for real? I'm glad I didn't pay because I was on her guest list. I was hanging out backstage. But if I would have paid, I would have asked for my money back because I only enjoyed about three of them.
Appreciation for freestyle. It's unique, and I don't think it ever gets the recognition that it should.
But with
that said, I want to rewind and let's go with the nitty gritty, the roots of it, and how it became freestyle.
So, all right. So for me, the way I walked into this, I was in 1980 in the High School of Music and Art, and I was an extra in the movie Fame. Mm. I had Irene Cara in front of me singing because I was in the choir. Song number 3 on the actual Fame album is My Class. Mm-hmm. And my teacher, Anthony Evans, wrote that song. It's called Never Alone. So from there, I got to see all this dancing and acrobat stuff happening for this movie Fame. And I was like, I want to be a part of this. I want to go and do this myself. Mm-hmm. So then I enlisted in Julia Richmond's after school program called Talent Unlimited, Professor Tackle. And in that class was Lisa and Brenda K. Starr.
Mm-hmm. Which I know both.
And I went to school with them and we would dream mm-hmm. about what we're gonna do. We didn't talk too much because we were in competition to get the lead. I was trying to get the lead of Oklahoma. They were doing the musical. And but little by little, I started working with them in different ways. I ended up doing backup to Brenda K. Starr's Drive Another Girl Home, which is about drinking and driving. It's on the flip side of one of her albums. And then I became Lisa's backup singer on live tours. And that's how Amoretto was born. So there was no freestyle. I come through contemporary, it was called contemporary dance music. And it went from there to Latin hip hop. And then it went to freestyle. It had to do with a dancer that was in a club that Sal saw the guy and said, this guy danced freestylish. And I'm like, what does that mean? And it all got connected to our music. I don't know who the guy was they saw dancing, but brought other dancers that did the same thing on the dance floor. I think it was the Devil's Nest.
Oh, the Devil's Nest.
And there. Yes. And that's how it got connected through the Italians. They started calling it freestyle when it really wasn't. That's what I'm understanding.
Yeah, but that's.
That's what I'm understanding, that it got called that way because they started dancing to that music, the freestyle music, which was really Latin hip hop, which is contemporary dance music. That's what Columbia Records was calling it. And then all of a sudden, Lisa got put into the top 100 Black Billboard charts. And I said, damn, that's it. We're not going to be able to open that door. So I said, I got this thing I'm thinking of doing a 3-girl group, Amoretto. I went to the right producer, Ray Serrano, through Charlie Chase, Africa Islam, Ice-T, Houdini, Cold Crush Brothers. I went through them and said, I'm looking for a producer. Can you get me a guy that could put Latin into hip hop? Because I was already done with the hip hop. I was like, I'm hip hop out, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, I was a rapper, breakdancer. Too. I started like that.
I rapped as well. I was a rapper.
Yeah, and I remember doing the human beatbox was at Radio City Music Hall. And I was one of the breakdancers on the far left of the stage and somebody discovered me. And from there, I started doing shows locally.
The human beatbox from the Fat Boys?
The human beatbox.
The Fat Boys.
The Fat Boys, that's Charles Stutler. He was their manager.
Yeah, and we did
Tin Pan Apple. Remember Tin Pan Apple?
Yeah, and we did at Radio City, BLS.
Apple,
That's how I got started.
Yeah, we were there.
Yeah, so you know what I'm talking about? My hair's going up. Yep. Oh my God, you guys.
Well, Charles Stetler sent him to Switzerland.
Well, I was.
And he's the organizer of the whole Tin Pan Apple. Yes.
Well, I was the girl on the left, always on the left side. I had a big butt. Now I got a big butt, a big stomach too. And I had the shortest hair. If you see the picture, you're going to go, I know who you was. Yeah, yeah. I used to roll with Africa Islam and Rocksteady Crew. Mm-hmm. After that, we went on tour. I used to help them as an assistant. Until they graffitied up the side of a McDonald's and they threatened to cut off Africa Islam's braids, his hair, with shotguns. I'd be like, okay, we're not doing this no more, guys. That was Gary, Indiana. There's a lot of stories, you know.
That's great. But where are you originally from?
So I was born in Manhattan, was raised in the Bronx, and now I live in Manhattan.
Okay. What part of the Bronx did you live
in? Parkchester.
Oh, in Parkchester.
And when you started the music, where were you living?
I was living on Watson Avenue in Leland, one block away from...
In the Bronx.
From,
In the Bronx.
So you used to hang out at Herpes Triangle?
I was... The Riddlers.
I remember Riddlers.
For that place.
Yeah, that whole strip. And it's still happening. If you go there now, it's crowded.
Isn't
on
that
a Friday,
the last stop on the 6th train or the 2nd train?
No, the last stop is Pelham. Oh, yeah. It's one stop away from Castle Hill.
Right.
It's a few stops before that, but yeah.
So from there, I was like, well, what's this thing called freestyle now? Because we're considered, clave rock, that song's really considered the tip of disco, salsa, dance music. That's what it's considered. They stuck us into the freestyle.
Yeah, because in the 90s, there was no disco.
Yeah.
There was no disco, so they couldn't give you...
You mean the 80s?
Well, you did this in the 80s?
We did this in 85.
Yeah, there was no disco already. It died out.
It was dying out.
But still, they were considering us as some type of a group that could bring back the disco a little bit.
What was it on the chart?
They were hoping for that.
On the chart, where you were on what? Contemporary?
We ended up... No. That's a good one. I think it was dance.
Dance, pop.
Yeah.
Probably pop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have a question. So Niobe, I'm a good friend of mine's, and I know her, you know, many years, you know, and I knew her before she came out with her song. They anointed her as the first freestyle singer. Do you agree with that?
Well, Niobe, let me explain why they say that, because let me tell you the honest truth.
And she's full of talent.
Niobe was the first booked artist we opened for her in a cable show called City Beats. It was TV local.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and so if I really think back, if I go all the way back into time, I keep seeing her. I keep seeing Leatherman Lanes, Tina B.
I remember Cover Girls.
No, they came later.
They were in the...
They came a little later.
Naomi, I know who Naomi is.
She was one of the first singers.
But people argue that Shannon was, but Shannon was not considered anywhere near freestyle.
Shannon
was considered more R&B.
She was in a...
R&B dance, but she somehow got into freestyle with that.
That Shannon did?
Yeah.
Give Me Tonight? Was it Give Me Tonight?
Yeah.
That's the song.
So, but there's a category for... I wrote about this. She has her own category, but she's doing freestyle shows now. I did the whole research on her.
You're talking about Shannon?
Shannon, she had her own.
She was at the Radio City.
Yeah, she has her own category.
Yeah, she was good, yeah.
If you research it, you'll see what she's up under. Mm-hmm. She's not under freestyle.
But she was in the freestyle.
But she's now, she's now in that because freestyle evolved so far, because don't forget, Hanson and Davis has that style flavor, mm-hmm. and he's in the freestyle too. Mm-hmm. You know, hungry for your love.
Hungry for your
so life. That whole flavor is something like Shannon, like that. So it's going to come together because they didn't develop R&B dance. They didn't think there was no way to get... It was contemporary dance, but no one bid on it. And David German, a friend of mine at Columbia Records, told me that we should consider ourselves contemporary dance music.
See, in the middle, when I remember the middle where everything, like, you know, when it went from genre to genre, if you think about when Crystal Waters and CNC from Music
That's
Factory,
true.
That era, we didn't know what to name that because it was pop, but it wasn't freestyle.
I was calling it urban pop.
Urban pop.
I was calling it that, but they almost got smacked for saying that. I was like...
Right. And that's when that transition went, because that's right after what we called freestyle, your guys' era.
Now, as a freestyle artist, you traveled the world also?
Well, at the time when our song did so well. I got to travel, you know, to different places. Didn't get to go out of the country as much as I thought I would.
I don't think freestyle is.
It didn't really.
It didn't evolve around the world.
Like that.
It was a New York thing, and then it went to a few states.
Yeah.
And that's it. And I think maybe Hawaii got a little bit of it, you know, but California got Florida, but it wasn't a big, big thing.
And the thing with the freestyle was, I feel that a lot of the reason why also it kind of died out too was we were getting older, and it's all kind of, if you look at the freestyle genre, really it's a lot of girls
singing. It's all young.
And they all wanted to have babies and get married. I heard Lisa telling me one time, Lisa, mm-hmm. I'm going to get married, I'm going to have kids, I don't know. You know, I'm like, oh. So,
She's traveling every week and her two kids are home.
Well, they're grown now.
Well, they're
pretty much they all took breaks in the 90s to raise their kids. Yeah. Even Chrissy Ais is now back. Mm-hmm. Her kids are grown. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? They all, for some reason, the promoters and producers said, well, we're going to have to give this a little bit of a break. Even they wanted to raise their own kids.
The break destroyed everything.
Because, for some reason, the Latinos, we was all Latinos in this freestyle. Mm-hmm. We was into, like, our family, kids, let's do this.
Yep.
We'll be back. I'm like, damn, when are you going to be back?
And truth be told, 80% of them weren't making a lucrative living out of it.
No, it was
You know, they were all working. Everybody was working and doing their weekend things.
Mm-hmm.
Because I tell everybody, I did a panel recently and I said, do you think that if we would have known what was going on today in the world, how much money like Wiggles and them made, that any of us would have fucking stopped?
Yeah.
If I thought I can do this as a living, we would have never stopped. But we had to go work, raise children, and it ended.
We had to become adults.
Yeah. It ended, basically. Yeah. I came back after 30 years.
Well, you know what I'm finding now, which is an interesting thing, and this is why I'm excited about the fact that I could even still come out today and stand and even talk about this, because I should be looking all old with white hair and a cane, but I'm not. I'm taking care of myself for this moment,
right now,
that I came to find out that the kids know it. I'm like, well, how could that? My neighbor, her kid, he's like 15. Ma, play that freestyle track again. I'm like, my neighbor, I forgot we raised the kids listening to the freestyle at home. So now you got these 15, 16, 17-year-olds, they kind of know about this
music.
But
how do you think I know Motown?
My mother.
My mother.
I have everything on Motown.
My mother, my father. How do you think I know Fania All-Star? How do you think I know rock?
So it's not really dead if you think about it.
It passes on. The only thing is, with the new genres that come out, right? The kids evolve to what's happening.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean it's not back here.
It's there.
It's, you know, it's still back here. Yeah. You're entitled to come out. You're entitled to do it. Absolutely. And you should.
Yeah, yeah.
You should,
I'm excited to, you know, hear you sing.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
You know, sing for us today, right?
Yeah. I got a new song.
Yeah, we want to hear it.
So,
what's the new song about?
Okay. So, this is a new song. It's called And I Love You. And it's a song, I was thinking how freestyle is always about love, right? You know?
It is.
Breakup, so, love and breakup.
Yeah, love and breakup, right?
Even whether it's
or
slow or fast.
Catastrophe.
Yeah.
Where you're saying, please take me back. So, or you're asking to get to know you better.
Welcome to the Boricua world.
Yeah, I know, right? Mucho lengua. So entonces, I figured I have to write the ultimate love song that could be used in a wedding. That's what I wanted. Mm-hmm. So my producer says, well, why don't it be more universal where it could apply to anyone and anyone at any moment in time? And it's about the last three or four words you say before tragedy happens.
Oofa.
Or right before you get married, or after you get married, or after you're done with the honeymoon and you're like, you got to go back to work. It's those words, and I love you, you say. All the time, don't you?
Yep.
Right before you hang up, and I love you. Like, this is what we say, us Latinos.
It is.
So I wrote this song about
Let's not leave the Italians behind, because they say
In the song, I have a little thing that I say, ti amo in Italian, and then mi amor in Spanish. But I'm in the frame of mind now to write the ultimate love song, I figured in freestyle, in a kick-ass beat. So I got the only producer that could have done it for me, which is Keith Kemper. He's a top 100 Billboard dance EDM chart producer.
Good for you.
And awesome. He took this shot. He doesn't do no real freestyle. Well, he did freestyle back in the day, remixes for others, but nothing like this from beginning to end. And it's for me, this is a total, this music was done under stricted guidelines. I had to make sure there was no alcohol in our body, no cigarettes, no heavy food, nothing. I had to do this song completely pure. I flushed out my system, drink a lot of water. He did too. We were like, we're going to put this song, make it all, you know, blessed by God. This is going to be the song. My hairs are going up. It's going to revolutionize what I feel freestyle really meant. So it's about love. The last three or four words you say, either before a tragedy happens
or after,
or that it's already happened. And
two questions, you know, then. What's the BPM on it and what's the category?
So the BPM, I think it's, 118.
Okay, so it's a dance song.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
It's freestyle dance.
Okay, I thought you were talking about love song and you were going to serenade it.
You're going to see.
Do a Sade.
You're going to see.
So it's 118 beats per minute.
It could be a freestyle wedding song. It's freestyle pop.
So you're going to get a bunch of people going viral dancing to it.
It's freestyle pop.
Okay, good for you.
I like it. So I have another question, right? And it's kind of like a little bit out of the box here. Being a girl from the Bronx, right?
Yeah.
What does boogie mean to you?
Boogie down Bronx.
Okay.
Man, I'm from Brooklyn. Don't go too far.
It has to, for me, it's the dancing, the boogie, the whole, you know.
Because you know, boogie fits in every category from dance to music.
I think that we need to bring back the
boogie.
The boogaloo. Do you know what I'm talking about? The electric boogaloo.
Yeah, but don't speak to him about electric boogaloo.
Why?
Because he hates it.
No, it's not that I hate it. It's because it's not in the category.
Of electric boogie.
That's what it is.
Well, boogaloo is different.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
So we need to talk about that. I like to bring that word to the forefront. And what I'm going to do next, I like to feature dancers that can dance that.
See, I take a little more personal because boogaloo to me has always been a Latin Afro thing from Harlem.
Right.
You know, and it has its own culture and it has its own artist and it's not associated with the street that we were coming from our era, which is boogie. We always, we were the boogie down Bronx. We used to go out and boogie, right? And you know, we used to rap boogie and we used to sing boogie.
But no one's doing it now, right?
Right,
because it's not as popular.
But
there's a group of people trying to bring it
back.
Well,
use me as an instrument. Don't forget I'm here.
Well, that's what we're doing. And we have Tiny Love. Yes. Same thing,
I'm official. You can definitely put me on.
We were all there.
Yeah.
I was there.
So, you know,
in the beginning.
You know, the whole boogaloo thing comes later. It's not original to the hip hop culture.
But we can keep going on with that. Listen, we got to wrap it up.
Okay.
We have half hour. We want to hear her sing.
Absolutely. Right.
And I want to thank you so much for coming
thank
on board.
Thank you so much for having me.
Because this is literally, this is for our trailer and our first and
thank
second
you.
Episode.
Yes.
And we're hoping that, you know, it blows up. So we can always have the same people that started with us come back and finish with us.
Sounds like a plan.
So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Gracias. Thank you.
Hi, Poppy.
Hi, Poppy.
Hi, Poppy. Thank you.
Thank you.